What's a particle? So, classically, of course, a particle is a point-like entity characterized by a mass of some kind. Could be zero mass. I guess it's a tachyon. It could have some weird imaginary mass. It's characterized by spatial degrees of freedom, meaning it has a location in some notion of physical space, usually XYZ coordinates, if you want to think of it that way. It will generally have something like different locations, different moments in time, which we can think of as being like a trajectory. You know, if it's a truly point-like particle, then it has no internal structure. It has no volume. Nonetheless, it can carry certain other quantities. It can have other attributes like electric charge, which are related to how it interacts with fields and other kinds of particles. It can have an intrinsic form of angular momentum. So just as you can have kinetic energy, but kinetic energy can kind of be frozen in and become kind of rest energy, like an internal energy of a particle. Angular momentum is a kind of motional kind of momentum, a kind of rotating momentum, but you could also have a frozen in kind that's called intrinsic spin. Particles can carry that intrinsic spin that can be converted into other forms of angular momentum, just like rest mass can be converted into other forms of energy. So these are what a particle is. It's a thing with this collection of possible properties. In quantum mechanics, at least since Wigner's work on representation theory, particles have been understood as the simplest kinds of quantum systems that have a well-defined nature or behavior under space-time transformations. So if you ask, what's the simplest kind of quantum system with a Hilbert space that is as small as possible, doesn't include anything extraneous, but for which when we move around in space or turn around or change inertial reference frame, change frame of motion, we just get a new element of the same Hilbert space. We don't get something new, but it's like minimal, it's irreducible. Then you have a math problem. What are the irreducible unitary, which just means they're represented by, you know, certain kinds of operators in the Hilbert space, representation of the space-time asymmetry group, the Poincaré group, the abstract representation of moving around in space, changing frame of motion, rotating. And that's a math problem. You can classify it. And what you find is there are distinct kinds of Hilbert spaces with these properties, and they are characterized by mass and by spin and by charges, and they have motional degrees of freedom and so forth. That's usually how we think about particles in quantum mechanics. And that's all we can say in quantum mechanics, because all we've got are Hilbert spaces in the textbook formulation. If you want to describe a system of particles, you just got a Hilbert space. And so all we can do is talk about what that Hilbert space, what its structure is, and its structure for a particle is related to these transformations of space-time. In the picture I'm proposing, particles go back to the classic-like picture. A particle is a point-like object in space, in, you know, three-dimensional physical space, if we think that space is physical space is three-dimensional, with various properties or dispositions interacting with other particles.
Dispositions?
Yeah. That is, when you interact with a particle, it may be disposed to give you certain results on your measuring device, is all I mean. So if you measure its position, you'll read off what its position is. But if you measure some more complicated feature, then what you get on the measuring device will be some more complicated result of the interaction with the particle. So it has a disposition to produce certain kinds of behavior. In metaphysical speak, we would say that certain properties are categorical. They just explicitly exist as they are, and others are dispositional. That is, you look at them, and what you're seeing is really like how the particle will be disposed to show you what it's going to do. But at the end of the day, particles are much more like they are in the classical picture, just point-like entities with some properties, with different positions through time. So that's all a particle is, according to this picture. And I should say that I'm not saying that particles are the fundamental ontology of nature. I don't know what the fundamental ontology is.
But so far in your theory, what is the fundamental ontology?
We go back to the old classical way of doing things, that if you want to model a given system, you propose a certain ontology for it. You have to say what you think the configurations are. If you want to model particles, it's going to be arrangements of particles. If you want to model fields, it's going to be, you know, delocalized field intensities distributed throughout space. If you want to model strings, if you want to model bits on a computer register, you pick the right ontology for the right kind of a system, and then you model it. It's possible there is some truly fundamental ontology of all of nature. I don't know what that is. I think to some people, especially people working in Everettian quantum theory, the idea that the fundamental ontology is state vectors or wave functions in a Hilbert space is very appealing. It would mean we already know what the fundamental grounding of all of reality is. A Hilbert space. There's some Hilbert space, and there's an object or objects in a Hilbert space, and that is the fundamental ontology of everything. I'm not saying that. Hilbert spaces are not fundamental in this picture. We go back to really having to be kind of metaphysically humble. We know about some systems. Some systems appear to be particles, some appear to be fields. Maybe particles are emergent from fields and we don't need particles as a separate category. Maybe fields are fundamental, maybe they're not. I think it's premature to try to guess at what the fundamental ontology is just yet. And in this picture, you don't have to. You just pick whatever ontology you need for the model you want to talk about. Particles, fields, registers on a computer. And then you proceed from there. Maybe one day we'll discover that there is one model with one ontology from which we can get all the other models. That would be a very exciting day, but I don't think that we can guess what that is today. And I don't think that we can just take that to be Hilbert spaces and be done. I think that's premature.
There's so much more I want to talk to you about.
We didn't talk about causation either. And there's a whole other, you know, connection to causation.
Reichenbach's common cause.
Right, we didn't talk about Reichenbach's common cause principle and... There's some really, this is the other reason I think that this work is potentially interesting, because it has some connections to causation that I'm very excited about.
I think we should explore that next time.
Yeah, maybe we should talk again.
Yes.
Yeah.
Professor, it was wonderful to see you in person. I've been following you politely, diplomatically, whatever.
Yes, of course.
You understand.
Yeah.
For quite some time now. And... why don't we end? I know you're about to rush off to see your students. Why don't we end with your advice to students?
Oh.
Actually, two. Your advice to students who are watching and researchers who are watching.
I'll just use my standby advice, which I think has been really helpful to me. And people have told this to me, and maybe I'll share this. We all come at the work we do with a distinct profile of strengths and weaknesses, like I just said. You know, every person is, you know, our particular set of strengths and weaknesses is like a point in a very high-dimensional configuration space or parameter space. So we're not rankable. You can't order people. We're not an ordered set. It's very easy for students going into science to think that they lie on a linear ranking system. They're people who are better or smarter than they are. And if they're not as smart as those people, they can't make contributions, they can't do good work. And in my experience, having worked with so many students over the years, but also having read a lot of history of science, we discover is that it really is true that we're all points in some very high dimensional parameter space. We're not rankable. And figuring out how your unique profile of strengths and weaknesses can be brought to bear to make progress on work that you find meaningful, that's figuring out how to do that is part of what it is to go into an area of scholarly work and grow and learn and develop. So I would say don't worry too much about where you think you fall in the ranking and focus more on figuring out how to bring your unique profile to the table and how to use it to make progress on things you find meaningful. That's probably my best piece of advice.
And for researchers who are watching, not advice, but any message that you'd like to, well, you can give advice as well.
Interdisciplinarity is wonderful. We should have more focus and spend more money on the places where disciplines intersect. I work at the intersection of physics and math and philosophy, and I guess now, you know, statistics, like, you know, dynamical systems. Like, there's so many different fields that sort of meet where I'm currently working. And I think this is not novel to say, but I think some of the most exciting work happening in scholarship generally, and certainly in science or philosophy in particular, is happening at interdisciplinary boundaries. So I would say that maybe not for the researchers, but for the people who pay researchers, spending a little more time thinking about how to promote work at the boundaries of disciplines where there's real cross-pollination between disciplines, I think would bear a lot of fruit for progress in all of our work.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.